Thank you very much. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome everyone to First United Methodist Church, the church in the heart of Princeton. We're glad you have joined us today for worship, and we ask you to complete the online or printed card, the Connect card that you will find in your bulletin. Please fill this out, and you can place it in the offering plate later during the offering. Information about our church is available on our website. And when you're posting to your Facebook or any other forms of social media, it would be appreciated when you tag the church. Please remember to check it out on a regular basis. If you're attending our church for the first time as a guest, or you're returning home for a visit, we welcome you and extend a special thanks for being with us. We pray that this time of worship is meaningful and spiritually moving as we become one voice coming from various places to offer a course of praise to God. Amen. This morning, we have two ladies that are going to present missions minutes. I'd like to first ask Martha Cook to come forward. Martha.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Just want to give you a little update here on the TLC quilting and crocheting classes. We will be finishing up that next week. We've had a lot of fun. We'll be posting pictures of the group and their finished projects on the church website as well as the TLC Facebook page next week. We will be offering some quilting and crocheting classes again come this fall. There's ways that you can help us plan for this. Some of you have come to me and asked, will we do this again? So the answer is yes. So here's three ways that you can help us with our planning. First, on your Connect card, if you'll write quilting or crocheting there with your name. Second, if you could write morning or evening or Saturday class, that would help us to know. And we're going to look at doing this in the fall. So if September, October, November, if one of those months works better for you, if you'd let us know that as well, we can probably do a little bit better planning for that. As we get a date set and time, look into your remarker and bulletin, and I'm sure one of the other ladies will be up here to let you know more about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha. I'll tell you, these ladies are really, really growing their group, and they're very, very active. I'm in hope that time goes on, we'll be people in our congregation who have like hobbies or whatever you want to call it, will gather together like these ladies have and organize a group and so you can have fun associating with each other while also doing devotions and hearing the Word of God. It's a great thing, and it's a wonderful thing for our church to grow. And you don't have to be, I don't think you have to be a member of the church. I mean, if you've got a group of ladies and you've got a next door neighbor friend who's really a good fit for the group, invite them to come along, and you never know. You may bring someone to Christ. You may bring someone to First United Methodist Church. Our next ministry is brought to us by Sherry Price. Sherry?
Mine is actually a small group opportunity. I love summer weather. I love being outside, and I love my new deck that I put on my house. So I've decided to combine all those things and do a late summer into the early fall outside on the deck, kind of a small group study. My days off are Friday and Saturday, so I thought depending on what kind of response I get, it could be either Friday morning or Saturday morning. Not early like Bill Lewis does his thing, that's a little too early for most of us, but a Friday or Saturday morning, and I thought Cheesy Sherry would call it Donuts on the Deck. We won't start till after VBS is over and behind us, but if you're interested, give me a shout out, okay?
Wait a minute. Next on our agenda, according to the message here, it's announcements and glory sightings. And I've asked Sherry to wait for a moment and to give us her new glory sighting. Sherry?
We celebrated the marriage of Christine and Wes. It was a beautiful day, and they are back from their honeymoon. So a God sighting, a glory sighting there, for a beautiful a wedding and a beautiful marriage and life ahead. So Mr. and Mrs. McKinney.
They're both real shy, but I'm going to ask them to stand up. You all may not know them. Christine, you have our condolences, honey. Now, another glory sighting. I'm going to ask Pastor Rexrode if he would please give his glory sighting. I'm out of script here, so he's not ready.
It is my pleasure always when we have new members who join the church, whether by profession of faith or by transfer. And as previously members of Central United Methodist Church, Christopher and Grace have transferred their membership here to be members of the First United Methodist Church in Princeton. So Christopher and Grace, you can stand up. We welcome you into the membership of the church and trust that you will continue to be faithful in your service.
Those are two great glory sightings. Does anyone else have a glory sighting they'd love to share with us? Okay, hearing none, we'll go on with the announcements. If you would please pick up your What's Happening brochure. There are a ton of activities going on during July and August, and I'd like to just go over a few of them this morning, if we could. Of course, Martha mentioned about the quilting and crocheting classes. Very special, July 16th through the 19th, that starts next week, Vacation Bible School from 6 to 8 p.m. from July 16th through the 19th. The Finance Committee, please note this date, July 24th, finance meeting at 6:30 in Shell Hall, followed by the next evening with Staff Parish Relations Committee, also at 6:30 in Shell Hall. Now, looking ahead in August, it's never too early to say things like this. Our church picnic is on August the 6th, and the time is to be announced later, but you can mark that on your calendar, August the 6th for the church picnic. And then on August the 27th, the youth are gonna have a block party, okay? It's not block party, but anyhow, they're having a block party on the 27th. If I could back up for just a moment, there's a very special announcement on August the 8th. The youth and the children will be at Amy's House of Hope, and they'll be serving dinner that evening. It's a very special evening. The kids have a lot of fun, and they do a lot of great for the community. If the youth or child have not participated before, I can assure you it's a great opportunity for them to, and the blessing that they will receive by working at Amy's House of Hope. If we could please, if you'd stand, we have a gathering together in worship by singing Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, found on the United Methodist hymnal in number 384. Please stand as you're able.
Thank you. Please join me in the call of worship.
Let us bless the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Praise the Lord. Up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways and that we may walk in his paths. We'll now have the morning prayer. And I ask that we all join in one voice as we pray the prayer projected on the screen, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we come before you this day as your people, eager to be in your presence. We cut out with the hymn writer John Wesley, "My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad, the honors of thy name. We humble ourselves before you, asking that you would fill us with the Holy Spirit, that we may be the people you are called for us to be. Teach us what it means to be blessed, that we may share your blessings with others. Empower us for holy living and align us to worship with you with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength this day and every day. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before we sing our first hymn, we have so many things going on. I forgot a couple of things that Brandon has going on. For the children and the youth, on July the 15th, they have movie night. And to top that off, the youth have a Carowinds trip on July the 26th. So don't forget those two events. Now, let us join together and sing, "Father, I Want to Be a Christian." The words are displayed on the screen or may be found in the United Methodist Hymnal number 402.
Thank you.
going to shift again from the bulletin because I can. I forgot to ask you to look at the prayer list, the members of our church, our church family who are ill. They need your prayers. I ask a special prayer for little Nicholas Walton. He's the grandson of our church secretary, Pam Johnson. This little 9-week-old baby is having a tough go of it. And I asked Pam what we could do, and she says, pray. Pray harder. And I'm asking everyone to do that, if you would, please. I'd also like to ask that we remember the family of Jacob Santon. Jacob was a longtime member of our community, 90 years old when he passed away. But I'd ask that we remember Jacob's family in this time. Are there any other special requests for prayer? We'll say a special prayer for A.B. and his family. If there's nothing else, I'll get back to the program, and we'll have our scripture reading. It's from Psalm 67, verses 1 through 7, and I'll be reading from the NIV. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face shine on us so that your ways may be known on earth, your salvation among all nations. May the people praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. May the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples with equity and guide the nations of the earth. May the people praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you. The land yields in harvest, its harvest. God, our God, blesses us. May God bless us still, so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. We will now have our special music by Dr. Tim Mainland, and Maggie Giseo, Echo di Primavera. Yeah, that too. Primavera.
Means here comes the spring.
Trust me, folks, I practice this all day long and I still can't get it right.
Just say, sorry. Here comes the spring.
Okay.
Oops. Oh, if I can not mess it up here.
Thank you.
Thank you both. Very beautiful.
Amen.
Pastor.
As we prepare ourselves for a time of prayer, I think you remember last week in the sermon I said we need to get used to using these altars again. Prayer time is a time that we go before God and we give Him our burdens and we hear from God at the same time. Maybe you're carrying a special burden this day for either yourself or for a loved one. And you want to come and make the kneeling rail, or I like to call it an altar, a special place where we leave our sacrifices before God and ask God to meet that particular need. Before I begin to pray, if anyone would like to come and come to the altar, I invite you to do so as we take our petitions and our prayers to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come into this sanctuary today to worship and to celebrate You, the giver of all life. And as we've heard the song, Here Comes the Spring, we realize that all life springs from You. All good things come from You. You are the great giver, the creator, the most merciful God. And we thank You, dear Lord, for all of the life that You've brought forth in us. Not only physical life, but spiritual life that comes to us through the new birth, through being born again. And I pray, dear God, that those who do not know the experience of being born of the Spirit, that this would be a day that they find the day of salvation, a day in which they come to experience You in a whole new and fresh way because You have come to take up residence in all of our hearts and lives this day. We come to You, God, as we mentioned last week at our service, mourning, a mourning people. Mourning because we realize that we are not perfect yet. As much as we desire to be and You've called for us to be, there are times when we still fail, that we do not do the things that You've called for us to do and sometimes do the things that You called for us not to do. We sometimes think that we know better than You and want to do things our own way instead of following Your voice and Your direction. And for that, Lord, we ask for Your forgiveness. For we know that Your way is the perfect way. And anytime we stray from Your way, we're straying from Your perfection and Your holiness and Your desires for us. And, oh, Lord, we pray, make us more like You. We bring before You this day the petitions that have been raised up that were mentioned. As we think of A.B., as we think of Nicholas, as we think of Amy's stepfather, Gary, and as we the others that have been mentioned this morning, Lord, You have heard all of these prayers, and You know each of them one by one, name by name. Nothing happens in this world that escapes Your attention. Nothing happens that is hidden from You. And we prayed, oh God, that You would minister in each of these situations, that where there is sickness, that You would bring healing, where there is death, that You would comfort those who mourn, that, Lord, that where there is disorder, that You would bring order, and where there is hatred, there is love, where there is evil, You would bring about salvation and bring salvation to this world through the blood of Jesus Christ and the presence of Your Holy Spirit. We go forward this day giving You thanks and praise for all of the good that You've brought into our life. We thank You, dear Lord, again for the opportunity to worship You this day and the opportunity to be in Your presence as the gathered people of God. Let Your Holy Spirit descend upon us this day. Let Your Holy Spirit be in us all throughout this week and every week. And may we always be the people You've called for us to be by the power of Your Spirit living within us. And we pray it in Your holy name. Amen. Amen.
Remind everyone of a special activity that we have immediately after church. We're going to have a reception for our new pastor and his family. Immediately following this, be over in the Shell Hall, actually in the gymnasium. So please wear your name tags.
Yes.
Wear your name tags because he's very forgetful, and it will help him out tremendously. Now, if you would please, if you would please stand as you're able. We're going to sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. The words are displayed on the screen. Also found in the United Methodist Hymnal number 400. And the children are asked to come for children's time as we sing the last verse.
Come thou fount of every blessing.
Children, you want to come on up? You can come on up. I've got some interesting stuff here this morning. Is that all right? Good. You everybody have a good week? Yes? Are you glad that it's been hot this week? No? Some of you like air conditioning? Some of you like the heat. I like the air conditioning. I don't like to be all hot and sweaty, but sometimes that's the way that it is. Well, I've got a bunch of stuff up here, and I'll tell you, this has nothing to do with the lesson other than I need it to catch the overflow. But this and these things all have something to do with the lesson I want to show you today. What is this? It's a jar, isn't it? And it's something that's made from the earth. Which jar is made from sand and a couple other elements what I can't remember. But you can make a jar, and glass is made primarily from sand, and it's heated up. Have you ever been to a glass-making factory? No? I've been to one or two, and they make glass. And I got this one that's clear, and I wanted to just, this kind of symbolizes who we are as people, okay? We were made from the dust of the earth, but the Genesis says that God breathed his breath into us and that we became alive. And so I want you to breathe into the jar, like just put some air into it. Can we breathe into it? Breathe into there. You don't want to? You want to blow in the jar? Put some air in there? All right, very good. No? Okay. So God put his breath in us and made us alive, so this is life. But what happened in the garden? One of the first things that happened in the garden is that when Adam and Eve used to walk in the cool of the garden with God, but then something happened. There was a voice that led them astray, as a serpent. And as that serpent led them astray, they began to, Adam and Eve, they chose to do what God commanded not to do. What did God say not to do in the garden, do you know? Yeah, do not eat the fruit of the tree of the garden. Do not eat from the fruit of the tree of good and evil. And what did Eve do? Yeah, she took from it and she ate. And when she did that, sin entered into the world. And so I'm pouring this Coke in here. Not that Coke is sinful, although judging by the number that it does on my stomach, I would say that it is. But the point of the Coke for me here is that it's dark, isn't it? Right? You can't see through that very well, can you? You can't see through it near as well as you could as when it was just filled with air, could you? So it's dark. And that's what sin does to our hearts. It darkens our hearts, and it keeps us from being transparent and allowing us to receive all that God has for us. But the good news is that Jesus came, didn't he? And Jesus came, and he died on the sin. What did he do? He died on the cross to take our sin away so that we could be free. And one of the ways that he does that is he promised to send back his Holy Spirit and pour it into us. And we know that God, everything about him is pure, isn't it? It's clear, this water is clear, it's pure. Hopefully it doesn't have any contaminants. But as God pours his Spirit into us, and he pours more and more of himself into this would work better if I had a pitcher, but it doesn't. But this became a little less dark, didn't it? A little more clear. And when we receive Jesus as our Savior, he begins to do a transforming work in us where he begins to set us free from sin. And some of that happens instantaneously. Sometimes we're delivered from sin instantaneously, but at other times, you know, we have sins that we continue to be pointed out to us as we grow in our life and we realize how dark we are. If I pour this in fast enough, it works better. I should have brought a pitcher. I didn't bring a pitcher. But the thing is when God continues to pour himself into us, there's less room for the ickiness of sin and there's more room for God. Now, because I didn't bring a pitcher, I've got to operate on the fly here for a moment, okay? So let me operate on the fly here for a moment. One more jar of water, right? If I have Christ in me and I become pure, I become what God intended for me to be, right? We're transparent. We can see through. The glass doesn't, the water doesn't contaminate. It actually fills us and gives us something. And that's kind of symbolic of the washing of baptism. Baptism cleanses us and sets us free. But the problem with that is sometimes even after we're baptized, you know what happens? Sometimes we do wrong things. We do the things we're not supposed to do that God says don't do, like cheat or lie or be mean to other people. And when we do that, it doesn't take very much sin to begin to make things cloudy, does it? And when we continue in sin, it clouds our ability to see what God wants to do with us, and it clouds our witness to others. And people sometimes ask, are you a sinner or are you a Christian? But as God continues, and if I would have used a smaller cup, this would have worked right. I didn't prepare well. And if I had a pitcher, I would have been better. But as God continues to pour himself into us and we say, God, forgive me of those sins. Take those sins away from me. He dilutes and takes that sin away from us and fills us with himself to the point that we eventually become clear again and receive of his grace. Now, this didn't work as perfectly as I wanted it to. I've done this illustration 3 or 4 times, and it's worked a lot better. I just didn't have all the right things this morning, and I ask for your forgiveness for that. But I want to share with you, is when this was shared with me, when I saw the overflow, and the overflow of the water that came out, it reminds me that Christ wants to overflow with us. He said he gives us streams of living water. He continues to pour himself into us over and over again so that he flows out of us, and we want to see Christ flow out of us. We don't want to see sin flow out in the darkness. We want to see Christ flow out. And I hope that Jesus Christ, that you know what it is to have your sins forgiven, and to allow Jesus to fill you with the Holy Spirit, that he can flow out of you and others can see the goodness of God in you. And they may be able to ask questions, what makes you like you are? And you could tell them it's Jesus who has made me pure, forgiven me my sins, and given me a new life. That's a bunch to take in this morning, isn't it? Little bit. But I just wanted to share that with you. This is one of my favorite illustrations of understanding what it is to be set free from sin and the darkness it provides and the purity of Christ. And I hope that you will know God's purity in your own life. Lord, we thank you for all that you do in our lives, and I pray that you would bless these children, that as they continue to grow, they would grow in knowledge of faith and the knowledge of your love for them, and that they would be filled with your Spirit so that all sin may be cast from them and they would know you as Lord and Savior, not only this day, but every day. Continue to fill us all with your Spirit that we may be clean and pure and free from sin. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you for letting me share with you this morning. Amen. Amen. Let us recite together our affirmation of faith as it is said in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We are thankful for the faith that Jesus Christ gives us. As we prepare to finish last week's sermon, let us hear again the word of the Lord. And it is my tradition that when we hear the word of the Lord, particularly from the Gospels, that we stand in reverence for the word. I invite you, if you would, if you're able, to stand with me as we hear again God's word. Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 12. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Last week we began the Sermon on the Mount, a series of messages on the Sermon on the Mount, and I anticipate these lasting for several weeks. And last week we began at the beginning with the Beatitudes. Of course, we talked about how the Beatitudes are the blessings that God bestows upon us and we find relevant in our lives. In the first of the Beatitudes, we saw that blessed are the poor in spirit, and we talked about what it means to be poor in spirit. It means to realize that without God, we are nothing. In and of ourselves, we have no merit, anything that we can take to Christ that would earn our salvation, that all of our goodness, everything good about us comes from God, and we are to give Him the glory for that, and to realize that we are totally dependent upon God. And so when we're poor in spirit, we realize we have nothing apart from God. The second Beatitude mentions that blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And we talked about what this mourning means, that this mourning is a sorrow over our sinful condition. It's a sorrow over the blackness of our heart when we know that we are lost in sin. It's a sorrow and a mourning and a contrition over the sin and the evil that exists in the world, not only in us, but in this world, as we live in a world that desperately needs redemption. That's a good place for an amen, by the way. This world is desperately in need of redemption. We see so much sin and evil around us, and we know that it breaks God's heart. And as we mourn, we begin to have our heart broken over the same things that breaks God's heart. We mourn, we're contrite, we're sorrowful. And when we confess our sin before God, it says that the blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. The good news is that when we confess our sin before God, He comes to us and takes our sin from us and gives us comfort, knowing that we have been brought into His presence and into His peace. And the third one what you talked about, the third blessing, is blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Once we realize that we are nothing without God, once we've confessed the darkness of our hearts and the sinfulness of the world and how we need to be cleansed from that, there is a humility that comes over us as we realize that God loves me. God loves you. God loves all the little children, doesn't He? He has called all of us to be in His presence, and so He loves us deeply and truly, and we want to experience that love and that humility of knowing where God has led us in this life. As we continue on, we've talked about Jesus began these Beatitudes in an order that talks about our need for God, our need for confession, our need for humility. And the triumph of that, the good news of it, comes in this fourth Beatitude, in which He says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Anybody ever been hungry? I think we've all been hungry, haven't we? Bill Lewis doesn't quit talking about smoking meat, I'm going to have my mouth's not going to quit watering. Every time I can turn around, you and Larry, I believe it is, the two smokers around here that like to smoke meat, and they talk about it. And I'm just like, sounds good. When am I going to get invited? Dinner time. Makes my mouth salivate. It gets dry. I just start wondering. But you know, as hungry as I've been, I don't think I've ever been starving hungry. I've been a few days without food. I've done the 30-hour famine. That kind of made me hungry. I've been sick at times, and when I was sick, I couldn't eat, but even then, I didn't want to come back. But I have been thirsty. I know what it is to be so parched that you just think that you're going to die if you don't get something to drink. You ever been there? Been out mowing the lawn in the heat like this? And you just think, I'm going to collapse, and you start feeling dizzy and weak, and I've got to have that. I crave it. Sometimes when I think of hunger, I think of those athletes who hunger for a trophy. They want it so bad, they do everything they can to have it. And what Jesus calls for us to do is to hunger and thirst for righteousness, that we are so that we are desperate for it, that we want it with our whole being. Just like those football players who want to win a trophy with everything that they have, or those baseball players, or any other person who competes for a trophy, they do everything they can to get it. And Jesus says that's what he expects of the Christian in regards to righteousness. What is righteousness? Well, it's part of it. It's being made right with God. But in this context and in this phrase, it is doing what is right. Doing the right things. Do we hunger and thirst to do what's right, or do we hunger and thirst to do what satisfies us, what meets our needs, what gives us the best advantage, which benefits us despite what it may do to somebody else? See, the righteousness of Christ is for the benefit of the world. The righteousness of Christ is for us all. And when we hunger and thirst for righteousness, we begin to want what God wants. We desire what is in God's desire, and we begin to think God's thoughts and to see things the way that God sees them, and we want to do right. To not only avoid evil, but to do what is right. Now, this is kind of summarized in Wesley's the General Rules of the Methodist Church. What are the general rules of the Methodist Church? Does anybody know what the first rule of a Methodist is? Do no harm, as I heard. What else did I hear? Do good, that's the second one. But the first one is do no harm. Well, that's how it begins. You know how the old-time Methodists talked about it? They picked up on the second phrase, because what Wesley said was do no harm by avoiding evil of every kind. So when we talk about doing no harm, we talk about, well, you know, if I cause harm, it might be because you hurt my feelings. It goes beyond harm. It goes to doing what is sinful. And so Wesley writes, and I have the Book of Discipline here, to do no harm by avoiding evil of every kind. Specifically that which most generally practice, such as, and Wesley gives a long list of things. I'm not going to read them all for time's sake. But he talks about taking the name of God in vain. I think that's something that comes from the Ten Commandments, doesn't it? The profaning of the Lord's Day. Again, honor the Sabbath. Drunkenness, buying, selling spirituous liquors, or drinking them, unless in the case of extreme necessity. Slave holding, buying and selling slaves. He talks about fighting, quarreling, brawling, going to law, brother against brother. Talks about taking advantage of each other, of speaking evil of other people. He talks about the singing of those songs or the reading of those books which do not tend to the knowledge or the love of God. And what he's talking about there is sometimes things don't have to be evil, but they can be things that just consume our attention so much that it drowns out our hunger and thirst for God. We have a world, we live in a nation that is consumed by entertainment. We all want to be pleased. We want to be happy. We want to be soft. We want to be comfortable. Dare I ask, do we spend as much time in prayer and reading our Bibles as we spend surfing through social media? Do we hunger and thirst for the things of God and pray over the needs of those things that have been brought to us as much as we sit back and watch program after program on the television? Do we spend time in Christian fellowship and the desire to be in the house of God and attend to the ordinances of God as much as we want to be out on the lake and having fun with others? Nothing wrong with those. Isn't it fun to be out on a lake? Yes. Are there good shows on television? Yes. There's some bad ones too, but there's some good ones. Are there things that are good in social media? Well, I don't know. But there's social media has its benefits, doesn't it? It's neither good nor bad. It's amoral. It's what we do with it. But the thing is, we can even take good things and turn them into something that consumes us to the point that we no longer are hungering and thirsting for God. But we're hungering and thirsting for the things of this world. And Jesus says that the disciple, the one who is blessed, is the one who hungers and thirsts for righteousness, because they will be filled. If you seek after righteousness, God will give it to you. He will pour his righteousness into you and help you by the power of the Holy Spirit to do good things. And the more that you do them, it's just like a habit. The more you practice it, the more likely it is to do. I've told people over and over again, you can skip church once, you can skip church twice, but by the time you skip it a third time, you start to form a habit. And sometimes it gets hard to go back to church. How many of us found it really hard to come back to church after COVID was over with? It was just easy to stay at home and watch church in your socks, wasn't it? And your PJs. And sit there and you didn't have to fellowship with anybody. It made it perfect. It was hard to come back and be in fellowship with one another because we became comfortable. And the same thing's true in our prayer life. When we start skipping prayer and we start doing it, it gets hard. But when we do it, it becomes part of our routine so that if we set aside time for prayer, we want to pray. If we get used to saying, okay, I'm going to church, then we come to church. And if I'm going to help somebody, you know, there's Amy's House of Hope. If I'm going to help with this, I just make up my mind I'm going to do it. It's going to be part of the schedule, and I don't have to decide every time. And we form those habits, and the more that we do something, whether good or bad, the more we're going to participate in it in the future. And so we need to hunger and thirst for righteousness. And that's the pinnacle of it. But let me hit on the next four, because blessings 5, 6, and 7 have to do with blessings 1, 2, and 3. How so? Blessing number 5, blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. You don't know how to show mercy and be merciful until you realize that you are nothing without God. It's God who helps us to be merciful. The next one is, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Well, when are we pure in heart? When we mourn over our sin and we are contrite over our sin and we offer up our sin to God and say, God, forgive us for our sin. And then it is that we are able, as He cleanses us from our sin, to make us pure in heart, that we become clean. And He says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Well, there's the blessed are the peacemaker. I'm telling you, you cannot be a peacemaker unless you're humble. Unless you're meek. The meek are not worried about themselves. They're worried about the community and about the others. They're worried about all. And the peacemaker is worried about peace in this world, but more than anything, they're worried that everyone would have peace with Christ. The peacemaker is concerned that you are set free from sin and that you know Jesus Christ as Savior so that you no longer have the turmoil in your heart of wondering about your relationship with God, but when you have been cleansed by Jesus Christ and have had the Holy Spirit to fill you, there's a peace that comes over you that is unlike anything that you can describe. Have any of you experienced that before? Have you known what it is to confess your sins and to leave them at the altar and leave them in the hands of God and know that He washes away our sins and takes them away that we may have joy and peace in our hearts? Our deepest need is to be blessed, but we don't get blessed by seeking blessings. We are blessed by being the people that God has called for us to be. And here in these Beatitudes, we find exactly who it is that God has called for us to be. The pure in heart, they see God. They see God because of their purity of heart. They are hungering and thirsting for righteousness and extending mercy to others that God has extended towards us. To be pure at heart is to be of one mind so that when something is pure, it is not contaminated, and we are not to be contaminated by sin, but to experience the wholeness of God, to be unpolluted, to be holy, to be sanctified, to be one-eyed, as some theologians have called it. The pure of the heart will have one thing, and that is to do the will of God, and that drives everything that they do. Those who are pure in heart become peacemakers, as I said, because they know the peace of Christ. They're not easygoing. They're not doing peace at any price. But they are concerned, as Martin Lloyd-Jones explains, that the peacemaker is one who is concerned that all men are at peace with God and at peace with all men to the extent that that is possible. And finally, that leads us to the result of being like Christ, being a Christian, that you will, knowing that when we are blessed and we are in the center of God's will and we're being who God wants for us to be, you're going to be persecuted. We're going to be persecuted. Anybody make fun of you because you're a Christian? Anybody make fun of you? Why are you going to church to gather with those folks on Sunday morning? There's so much other things that we could be doing. Why do you insist on integrity and telling the truth? If you just told a little white lie, it would be your life would be so much easier. Why do you worry about, you know, they make fun of us for all kinds of different things, about observing the Sabbath, gathering together as Christians, praising God. How could you even believe in God? That doesn't make sense. Don't you know we've all evolved? All the theories of the world, and those who are enemies with God will be enemies with Christ. Jesus told us it would be so. Jesus told his disciples that the world has hated me. He says it in John chapter 15, that don't be surprised if the world hates you because they have hated me first. And it wasn't only the world that hated Jesus, but it was often those that were even within the church, or should I say within the Jewish synagogue and hierarchy. Jesus often was most at odds with those who were in leadership, who had the outward appearances of righteousness, but inside they were still filled with darkness, with selfish intent, with self-concern, who was more worried about what others were doing than about their own righteousness. And part of the Beatitudes is a heart exam, isn't it? The Beatitudes are a heart exam. Are we poor in spirit? Are we meek? Are we merciful? I didn't mean to shut my Bible. Are we poor in spirit? Are we those who mourn over sin? Are we who are meek so that we're humble before God and all people? Are we those who are hunger and thirst for righteousness? Are we those that are merciful, that would receive the mercy of God and know that by the grace of God, there go I. And so we share that mercy with others, realizing when people are in the grip of sin, they are going to fall short. Are we merciful towards those who disappoint us and fail us, even as we have disappointed and failed God, and know how merciful he's been towards us and how many second and third and fourth chances he has given us? Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. And you know what children of God are? Children of God are those who belong to God. And if you belong to God and you're a son of God, what do sons get? Inheritances. Daughters get them too, but you get inheritances. And you get to inherit everything God has for you. You know God has a perfect plan for you and for your life. He wants for you to have it. And he's laid out here in the Beatitudes how to have it and get started. If you want to be blessed, live the life that he's called for us to live here. It's a humble life, a life that mourns over sin, a life that wants God's will above all things and realizes that we will stay true even when others turn against us. Now, some of you like the beach, don't you? Next week's sermon is the salt life. I think some of you are familiar with that phrase, aren't you? The salt life. We'll get into the salt life and salt and light. But understand that the Beatitudes forms the framework for all that follows in this series of messages and all that follows in the Sermon on the Mount. If you want to be blessed, if you want to be happy, be the blessed people that God calls for us in this passage and experience his goodness in your life, knowing that we do these things not by our own power or by our own strength, but by the filling of the Holy Spirit within us. By ourselves, we cannot be the people God's called us to be. But by Christ living within, we can be who God's called us to be. Invite Christ into your life this day. Amen.
We come to this moment to offer our gifts as a sign of offering our whole selves to Christ. Let us give joyfully in the name of the one who gave his all for us. Lord Jesus, receive these offerings as part of our worship of you. Amen. Amen. Would the ushers please come forward?
Thank you.
present the tithes and the offerings to you, thankful for all that you have done for us. We pray that as we present these, it may be a token of us presenting our whole selves before you to be used by you in whatever way that you would choose. Bless these offerings for the work of your kingdom, and bless the giver for the work of your kingdom, that everyone may know the name of Jesus, and it's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
Please remain standing as you're able for our final hymn, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. The words will be displayed on the screen and may be found in the United Methodist hymnal number 95.
Just a reminder, there is a reception. I'm going to pray for the food, and then I'm going to give you a blessing. I also, at this time, just want to say thank you, Brother Chip, for being here. If you don't know, the district superintendent's back there. And so it's great to have him in the worship with us this morning. Lord, we do pray for your blessing upon the food that we'll receive at the reception, and ask that you'd use it for the good of our bodies and the fellowship for the nourishment of our souls and our communion with you for the nourishment of our whole selves. Pray, dear Lord, that we would be beatitude people, that we would live in the beatitudes of which you spoke, that we may be the people that you've called for us to be. So now I pronounce on you that the Lord bless you and keep you, that the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, that the Lord was turn his face towards you and give you peace. Go in the strength of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.